this is your girl, Sonya Buchanan with Confident Promises Broadcast. Listen, we have a great program for you tonight. We are bringing you our Bible study segment. It's going to be wonderful. It's coming from the book of Genesis 26. We're going to talk about Isaac 30, 60, and 100-fold blessing. So stay tuned. Hi, this is Sonya Buchanan with Confident Promises Broadcast. I am so excited about tonight. We are doing our Bible study. I mentioned earlier today on our Motivational Thursday, because we did a segment on Genesis 26, and that I was going to extend and do a Bible study from that segment. And I'm excited about it because there's so many different nuggets about Isaac's life that I wanted to share with everyone that I know that it will bless you. It will definitely bless you. It blessed me. So let's go ahead and chime into our Bible study. I have my iPad here. You know, I didn't want to bring out all the books and all of that. I said, you know what? I'm just going to do the iPad thing and just give an overview. It's not going to be a long extended Bible study, but it's just going to be just a few points that I just wanted to bring home to everyone. So let's get started. We're taking it from Genesis 26. And let me just give you a synopsis of what's happening. And then I'm going to chime in at a point where I want to bring the importance of Isaac's life. Well, of course, you know, Isaac is the son of Abraham. And when the Lord called Abraham from his father's house, the father gave him a blessing that he will be blessed. He will bless nations. Well, Isaac was the child to give us this blessing, of course, you and myself. And this is what we're taking it from. Well, let me also explain during the time when Abraham left his father's house, he experienced a famine in the land. And at the time, Abraham dwelled in Canaan. And when the famine became apparent, he decided to go to Egypt, and him and Sarah went to Egypt. And but here, we're going to chime in at a point where the Lord was informing Isaac not to go to Egypt. Here it says, there was a famine in the land besides the first famine that was in the days of Abraham. And Isaac went to Amalek, king of the Philistine, in Gerar. Then the Lord appeared to him and said, do not go down to Egypt. Live in the land of which I shall tell you. Dwell in this land, and I will be with you and bless you. For to you and your descendants I give all these lands, and I will perform the oath which I swore to Abraham, your father. And I will make your descendants multiply as the stars of heaven. I will give to your descendants all these lands, and your seed all the nations of the earth shall be blessed. This is the same blessing that the father gave Abraham. So he's actually passing down. He's confirming the blessing that Abraham had given his son Isaac. So God is like, oh, I'm giving you the same thing that I promised your father. So this is almost like this inheritance, you know. And it goes on to Genesis 26:6. So Isaac dwelt in Gerar. The father told him to dwell in that land. Although there was a famine going on in this land, the father says, stay there, and Isaac obeyed the father. Okay? And it says in 6, so Isaac dwelt in Gerar, and the men of this place asked about his wife. And he said, she is my sister. For he was afraid to say she is my wife, because he thought, lest the men of that place kill me for Rebekah. Rebekah obviously was a beautiful woman. And let me just bring something home, because I like to give Bible studies and make it apparent, make it, you know, practical for 2017 or in the 21st century. And it talks about how beautiful he felt as though that they would kill him because of Rebekah, the beauty of Rebekah. And it just makes me realize that Rebekah really represents wisdom of the Holy Spirit. You know, when it talks about that scripture in Proverbs, it's he that findeth a wife findeth a good thing. Here we give it an example of what that means. She was beautiful. you know, excellent to look upon. So he was afraid that they was going to kill him for her. So he says, yes, he lied. She's my sister. Well, his father did the same thing with Sarah. Sarah had to be beautiful as well, because Abraham in Genesis said that she was his sister. So it goes on to say that the king looked out a window and saw Isaac and Rebekah smooching somewhat, you know, and he was upset. So he approached Isaac. He says, why did you tell us that she was your sister? And Isaac goes in and explained that he was afraid that there was going to be harm. So the king went and told everybody in the land, do not touch them, because he saw the beauty and he saw the blessings upon Rebekah. Isn't it amazing? It kind of reminds me of Christianity. When you see people that's anointed and you know that they're anointed, and you know that they're married and they have that glow and that anointing and they are beautiful, it's almost as they are like off limits. You have to be really careful about that. I always say, you know what, if you treat everybody with respect, then you won't have to worry about what the king is going through, having to tell everybody not to touch Isaac and Rebecca. But anyway, let's go on. And after there was a charge from the king that said, don't touch Isaac and Rebecca, bring no harm to them, Isaac sold in that land. Yes, the land was having a famine, but Isaac sold in that land. Here it says in Genesis 26:12, it says, then Isaac sold in that land and reaped in the same year 100-fold, and the Lord blessed him. The man became too prosperous and continued prospering until he became very prosperous, for he had possessions of flock and possessions of herds and a great number of servants. So the Philistines envied him. You know, I can see why they were envying him. Here in Gerar, there was a famine going on in the land. Isaac, who is blessed, that has that anointing on his life, sows in this land that is completely famine, and he's receiving blessings of 100-fold. Isn't that amazing? I believe that's what the life of living with the anointing of the Lord and Christianity. Because, you know, when you have Christ, you have him and he's anointed. So that will make you anointed. That's how I see it. But although there was a famine in this land, Isaac is like receiving these blessings. It's amazing. So the people envied him. You know, I think about envy. It's kind of like Cain, you know, when Abel sold in the land and here he is getting blessed from the Lord and Cain is like mad. This kind of reminds me of this. So the people in the same city that he lived in, now Isaac is like visiting, basically living in a land that is not even his, and he's receiving blessings. But they envied him. Apparently, they must not have been blessed as Isaac was being blessed. But it goes on and says they envied Isaac for sowing in the land. And after that, it goes on and it talks about it says, now the Philistines has stopped up all the wells which his father's servants had dug in the days of Abraham. So they envied Isaac and Rebekah so much they began to throw dirt. It says earth. In some Bibles, it says earth, but it all means the same thing as dirt. They started throwing dirt in the wells. You know, it just kept throwing dirt in the wells, you know, because they didn't want him to receive blessings. So I guess that was their way of retaliating against Isaac. Well, we're going to just get rid of your water because we know you need water to quench your thirst. So they started throwing dirt in the wells and started filling them up. And so the king instructed Isaac. He says in 16, it says, Genesis 26:16, it says, and the king, Abimelech, said to Isaac, go away from us, for you are much mightier than we. So then Isaac, in 17, it says, then Isaac departed from there and pitched his tent in the valley of Gerar. Now, it's amazing. He says, go away from us. Now, remember that the Lord gave him instructions to stay in Gerar. So he had to go in the valley of Gerar that was outside of the community of the Philistines. And he dwelt there. He still stayed within obedience. I can only imagine that he's probably, you know how if a city has like this gate around it, and so Isaac is probably like way in the fence of the gate trying to dwell and make sure he stay in obedience with the Lord. And it says, and Isaac dug again the wells of water which they had dug in the days of Abraham his father for the Philistines. Now, although he was told to go away, so the Philistines go where he is, and then they stopped up that well that he dug. This is what hatred and envy would do. I don't want to be around them, but you go to them when you told them to go away, and you're just going to bring havoc to their lives. So Isaac, he didn't get upset. He didn't get upset at all. He just packed his things up and he left. He went to another part of Gerar. And it says, right here it says, and Isaac dug again the wells of water which they had dug in the days of Abraham his father, for the Philistines had stopped them up after the death of Abraham. He called them by the names which his father had called them. Also, Isaac's servants dug in the valley and found a well of running water. But the herdsmen and Gerar quarreled with Isaac's herdsmen, saying, the water is ours. So now they're trying to take claims of something that's not even theirs. It was the forefathers prior before them. And said, so they called the name of the well Esek. And Esek means strife. Each of the names they call the wells has a meaning behind it. And then it says, because they quarreled with him, then they dug another well, and they quarreled over that one also. So he called its name Sikna. And he moved from there and dug another well. So here we have Isaac moving three times because of the strife that's going on over the wells that they're digging. Isaac, which was a man of God, he already know who he is. He's already blessed. He didn't bother to argue. He just moved. He moved away from that place. Like, you know what? You can have that well, and I'll just move somewhere else. And it says, and he moved from there and dug another well. And they did not quarrel over it. So he called its name is Rehoboth, because he said, for now the Lord has made room for us, and we shall be fruitful in this land. So after three times of moving, he moved the fourth time, and then there was room for him. I can only imagine how large this place is. And it says, in 23, it says, then he went up from there to Beersheba, and the Lord appeared to him the same night and said, now, it's amazing. Sometimes, you know, we think, okay, when is the Lord going to speak to us? Well, all those movings, Isaac did not give into any of the strife, any of the temptation of havoc with the people who was trying to claim the wells. The Lord showed up and spoke to Isaac. And the Lord says, I am the God of your father Abraham. Do not fear, for I am with you. I will bless you and multiply your descendants for my servant Abraham's sake. So Isaac built an altar there and called on the name of the Lord. And he pitched his tent there. And there Isaac's servant dug another well. Now, he's at peace. The Lord has spoken to him. They're getting settled. Now the king, Abimelech, shows up. He came to him from Gerar. And he brought all his servants, his soldiers, his army. And he says, why have you come to me? This is Isaac asking the king, why have you come to me since you hate me and have sent me away from you? He says, but they said, we have certainly seen that the Lord is with you. So we said, let there now be an oath between us between you and us, and let us make a covenant with you, that you will do us no harm, since we have not touched you, and since we have done nothing to you but good, and have sent you away in peace. You are now the blessed of the Lord. Now, isn't it amazing? Now his enemies are now coming to him. They see the anointing, they see the glory, and they see the blessings on Isaac's life, and they came to him to make peace. It's almost like, I'm coming to you, you know, I see that the Lord is on you. I want to make peace with you, and no longer have strife, because obviously, you're not going to leave our land, but I don't want any strife between you and I. This is what something that the Lord would do with your enemy. It says that he'll bring your enemies at peace with you. But one great thing that I'm excited about is that the king saw the Lord, and it brought peace to his heart. It brought repentance. To me, I think he had a pliable heart to actually see it. Because if you have a hard heart, he would have never saw the blessings on Isaac and Rebekah. This is something I just wanted to share with you. If you're having issues with enemies, what we call enemies, really, they just probably don't see the Lord. And we have to demonstrate that outwardly. Just keep our peace. Because the Lord will bring peace and harmony with those that are afflicting us or coming at us at such a harsh way. If you can maintain your God attributes, your character, your Christ-like behavior, representing him, he will sure bless you. And that's what the point that I wanted to bring to you. The story of Isaac and Rebekah, the Abraham blessings. It is the same with you today, the 30, 60, and 100-fold blessings. But, you know, take the time out and read Genesis 26. It will bless your heart. It will bless your heart. And ask the Holy Spirit to come with you as you read the story so he can bring out nuggets that will bless you at a place where you are right now. So that's what I wanted to bring to you. I'm so excited about bringing this story about Isaac because it is part of our blessings in 2017 or the 21st century. Until next time, this is Sonya Buchanan with Confident Promises. Bye-bye.